Expand your knowledge. The wisdom of God rules the world. Strive through your recognition, men, to perceive his magnitude. In the land of twilight. Let me take you a step into the ethereal realm, soul of man. We will hurry through the land of shadows without stopping, for I have already spoken about this. It is that plane where those must linger who are still too stupid to use their ethereal bodies properly, particularly those who, while on earth, considered themselves especially clever. In the ethereal realm, they are dumb, blind, and deaf, because the earthly intellect, as a product of their gross material body, could not accompany them into the beyond. Being earthbound, it remained in the narrow confines of the world of matter, which it can never overstep. The first consequence of this great error becomes immediately clear to a human soul after earthly death, for it stands useless in the ethereal realm, helpless and weak, much worse than a newly born child on the gross material earth. Therefore they are called shadows, souls which still sense their existence, but which cannot be conscious of it. Let us leave these foolish ones behind us, those who, in their conceited belief that they know everything better, prattled enough trivial nonsense on this earth, and who must now be silent. We are now entering the plane of twilight. A whispering reaches our ears, in complete accord with the dim twilight around us, in which we can vaguely recognize the outlines of hills, meadows, and bushes. Thus everything here corresponds to the state of twilight, which may be followed by an awakening. This only may be so, not necessarily must be so. No happy, cheerful sound, no clear vision is possible here. Only twilight, or a restriction which conforms to the condition of the souls sojourning here. These drag themselves sluggishly about, tired and indifferent, except for an indefinable urge, driving them in one direction, towards a faint, roseate glow, which seems to rise in the distance, and which, like a harbinger of light, affects these seemingly tired souls like sweet enchantment. They only appear to be tired. Actually, they are indolent in spirit, and therefore their ethereal bodies are weak. The roseate glow in the far distance beckons them onward, full of promise. Hope awakens within them, and they are stirred to quickened movement. Their desire to reach this glow gives fresh strength to their ethereal bodies. Their eyes reflect a keener consciousness, and they step out towards it with ever greater assurance. We accompany them. The number of souls around us increases. Everything grows more active and distinct. The speaking becomes somewhat louder, swelling to a strong murmuring. Soon we discern words, words that evolve into prayers, uttered by those jostling forward, uttered unceasingly, hastily, feverishly. The crowds now grow ever more dense. The forward movement becomes spasmodic, and whole groups in front of us come to a halt. They are being thrust back by those ahead of them, only to push forward again. Thus the jammed masses surge to and fro. Cries of despair, frightened entreaties, timid demands, and here and there a suppressed whimpering of utter helplessness arise from the prayers. Quickly we swing ourselves above this struggle of millions of souls. We see that before them, inflexible and cold, an obstacle checks their advance. An obstacle against which they hurl themselves, and which they wet with their tears in vain. a series of high, strong, and closely set bars relentlessly halts their forward movement. More brightly gleams the roseate glow in the distance, and still stronger grows the longing for it within those who have made it their goal. Beseechingly they stretch out their hands, still convulsively clasping their rosaries, and letting one bead after another slip through their fingers as they continue to stammer their prayers. The barrier, however, stands rigid and immovable, separating them from their beautiful goal. We walk past the dense crowds, which seem to be endless. Not hundreds of thousands, but millions. All faithful believers, at least so they thought while on earth. How different they had imagined everything to be. They thought they would be joyfully awaited and welcomed with respect. Call out to them. Of what use are your prayers, you believers, if you did not allow the word of the Lord to become active within yourselves, a natural conviction? The roseate glow you see in the distance is the longing for the kingdom of God burning within you. You carry this longing within yourselves, but you blocked the road leading there with the rigid forms of your false opinions, which are represented in the bars of the fence you now see obstructing you. Discard all the false views you accepted, and those you yourselves built up in addition during your time on earth. Throw them aside, and boldly step out for the truth, as it is, in its great and simple naturalness. Then you are free to attain the goal you long for. But see, you dare not. You are in constant fear that it might perhaps be wrong, because you have thought differently up to now. But you only hinder yourselves through this, and must remain where you are, until it becomes too late to stride onward, and you are bound to be drawn along into perdition. Nobody can help you with this, unless you yourselves begin to leave behind all that is wrong. Call out to them. Point out the way of salvation to these souls. You will see it is utterly in vain. The noise of their endless prayers only grows louder, and prevents them from hearing a single word that might help them to stride forward towards the roseate glow and the light. In spite of many a good volition, they must now perish as victims of their indolence, which prevented them from recognizing and absorbing anything more than the externals connected with their churches, temples, and mosques. Sad at heart, we want to move on. But there before us we notice the soul of a woman, whose face suddenly takes on an expression of peace and calm. Her eyes lose their troubled, anxious look and shine more brightly. As she attains to greater consciousness, her body becomes more erect and more transparent. A strong volition of purest hope helps her to raise her foot, and then, uttering a sigh of relief, she stands on the other side of the barrier. To the soul of this woman, the bars no longer formed any obstacle, for through deep meditation and delicate intuition, she became convinced that all she had hitherto thought must have been wrong. And with a joyous belief in the love of God, she fearlessly cast aside all her mistaken ideas. Now she is astonished when she realizes how easy it was. Gratefully she raises her arms. Her supreme happiness makes her want to sing with joy. But the magnitude of the experience overwhelms her, and her lips remain mute. She trembles slightly. Her head sinks down upon her breast, and she closes her eyes as big tears course slowly down her cheeks. She clasps her hand in prayer, but this time she prays in a different way. A prayer of thanks and a heartfelt intercession on behalf of all those who are still behind these hard bars because of the false opinions they refuse to surrender. A sigh of profound sympathy swells her breast, and it is as if the last of her fetters falls away. Now she is free, free to tread the path to the goal she inwardly longs for. Lifting her eyes, she sees a guide standing before her, and joyfully she follows him into the new unknown land, towards the roseate glow which becomes ever brighter. Thus many a soul still detaches itself from these masses, which must wait behind the bars erected by their erroneous opinions for their own decision, for their own resolution, which may lead them onward, or which retains them till the hour strikes when everything that cannot brace itself to cast off that which was formerly wrong will be destroyed. Few only will still be able to free themselves from the clutches of their false views, in which they are too deeply entangled. The bars that prevent their progress toward ascent are as rigid as their own stubbornness in clinging to these erroneous views. It is impossible to lend them a helping hand to overcome this obstacle, because it is absolutely necessary that the initiative should come from the souls themselves. It is their inner personal experiencing which activates their limbs. Thus an ominous curse falls upon all those who teach mankind wrong conceptions about the will of God in creation, which was at that time to be found in the word of the Saviour. But it was not purely preserved in the word of the Bible, still less in earthly explanations. Let them in their rigidity continue to prattle their prayers, under the delusion that the number thereof can and must help them, because the Church has taught them so, as if some bargain could be driven with the will of God. Let us continue our journey in the land of twilight. The stronghold of bars seems to stretch endlessly into the distance, and the multitude it imprisons reaches far beyond our gaze. But here we see other groups holding Bibles in their hands instead of rosaries, and desperately searching through the pages. They gather round a few souls who try to give instruction and information by continually reading passages from the Bible. Here and there, various souls lift their Bibles in a demanding manner. Others kneel and raise them as if in prayer. However, the bars remain immovable, preventing all possibility of advance. Many souls point to their biblical knowledge. Others demand their right to walk into the kingdom of heaven. But the bars do not budge. Then we observe the soul of a man smilingly forcing his way through the multitude. Triumphantly he waves his hand. "You fools," he cries, "why did you not want to listen? I spent half my time on earth studying the other world, which for us is now this life. The bars in front of you will quickly disappear through one act of your will. They are the product of your imagination. Just follow me. I will lead you. I am already familiar with all this." The souls around him give way. He strides towards the bars as if they do not exist, but instantly staggers back with a cry of pain. The impact was too hard, and very soon convinced him that the bars were real enough. He puts both hands to his forehead. The bars before him stand immovable. In a fit of rage, he seizes them and shakes them violently. Angrily, he cries out, then the medium has deceived me, and year after year I devoted to studying this. He does not realize that it was he who originated and spread these errors, both verbally and through his writings. After interpreting the pictures transmitted to him by the medium according to his ideas, and without first studying the laws of God in creation. Do not try to help this man or others. They are all so wrapped up in themselves that they have no wish whatever to listen to any but their own perceiving. They must first become weary of their plight, must recognize or comprehend its futility, for this alone holds the possibility of escape from the entanglement of wrong convictions after long wanderings in the land of twilight. These are not bad persons, but those who, in their seeking, have merely clung tenaciously to false conceptions, or who were too lazy to ponder over everything thoroughly, when they should have examined what they accepted with the most careful intuition, to see whether it could be considered correct, or whether it contained flaws, which their own healthy intuition must reject as unnatural. Therefore drop all empty superficiality. The human spirit should reject all mysticism, because it can never be of any value to him. Only that which he himself enters into with his intuitive perception, thereby bringing it to personal experience within himself, will be useful to him in the maturing of his spirit. The word awake, which Christ used so frequently, means experience. Do not go through life on earth sleeping or dreaming. Pray and work means make your work a prayer. Spiritualize the work of your hands. In its performance, every task should become a reverential worship of God, in gratitude that God has given you the chance to accomplish something extraordinary among all the creatures of this subsequent creation, if only you so wish. Begin timely with this awakening, with this personal experiencing of everything, including what you read and hear, which is the same as consciously perceiving it, so that you do not have to remain in the land of twilight, of which I have explained only a very small part today. Ponderers. The man who spends his days on earth in pondering about himself can never ascend, but remains hampered. So many people live in the belief, however, that just such pondering and self-observation is something especially great, which helps them to ascend. They have many words for it that veil its true nature. One person ponders in repentance, another in humility. Still others ponder assiduously in order to discover their faults and the way to avoid them, and so on. But it all remains a continuous pondering, which seldom or never permits them to experience true joy. That is not what is willed. It is a false road, and never leads upwards to luminous and free realms. For through this pondering, man binds himself. He directs his gaze forcibly upon himself only, instead of upon a high, pure, luminous goal. Cheerful, hearty laughter is the strongest antidote to darkness. Only it must not be a laugh of malicious pleasure. On the other hand, pondering weighs a person down, and this alone is enough to explain that it keeps down and also pulls down. Nor is the real basis of continual pondering a good volition, but only vanity, ambition, and conceit. It is not the pure longing for the light that gives cause to this pondering, but a craving for self-esteem that kindles it ever anew and perpetually nourishes it. The continued concentration of his thoughts upon himself is a form of self-torment. He zealously observes the alternate pros and cons working within his soul, feeling vexed at times, and then finding solace again, so that finally he can personally note with a deep breath of quiet self-satisfaction that once more he has overcome something and gone a step forward. I purposely say personally note, for it is really he alone who does most of the observing, and such personal observations are invariably nothing but self-delusions. In reality, he has not advanced a single step, but goes on making the same mistakes over and over again, although he imagines they are no longer the same. But they are the same, always the old mistakes, only their form changes. Such a man never advances in this way, although his personal observations give him cause to imagine that he is overcoming one fault after another. But he always revolves in a circle around himself, while the basic evil hidden within him does nothing but continuously create new forms. A man who is always observing and pondering over himself is the personification of the fighter against the nine-headed snake. No sooner is each head cut off than it grows afresh, making the struggle endless, with nothing to mark in the way of progress on the fighter's side. As a matter of fact, this is also the ethereal process resulting from the activity of a ponderer. In the olden days, when men considered everything not gross material to be gods, demigods, or other kinds of entities, they were still able to see this. Only a man of cheerful volition, who keeps his gaze freely concentrated upon a sublime goal, instead of continually focusing all his attention upon himself, only he will advance and ascend towards the luminous heights. No child learns to walk without frequently tumbling, but it almost invariably gets up with a smile until it is able to walk in safety. That is what man must do on his path through the world. Do not despair, lament, or complain when you sometimes fall. Get up briskly and try again. You must learn the lesson from each fall through your intuitive perception, however, and not through mental observation. Then there will quite suddenly come a time when you need no longer fear another fall, because you have inwardly absorbed everything the previous ones have taught you. Thus, man can only absorb through actual experiencing, and not through observation. A ponderer never comes to the point of experiencing. Through his observing, he always places himself outside every experience. Looking at himself with his dissecting and analytic mind, as if at a stranger, instead of exercising his intuitive perception to the full on his own behalf. If he looks at himself, he must stand beside the intuitive perception. The very words to look at oneself, to observe oneself, imply this. This also explains that he is but serving the intellect, which not only hinders every genuine experience with the intuitive perception, but utterly eliminates it. He prevents the effect of every outward happening in the material world from penetrating further than the frontal brain, where it is first received. There it is arrested, presumptuously dissected, and analyzed, so that it does not reach the intuitional brain, through which alone the spirit could accept it for experiencing. For mark my words, just as the human spirit must direct its activity from within outwards, that is, in proper sequence, over the intuitional brain to the intellectual brain, so the effects of outward happenings can only take the reverse course if they are to be absorbed by the human spirit as experiences. Thus the impression of outward happenings in the material world must, in coming from the outside, always go through the intellectual frontal brain, and thence via the intuitional back brain to the spirit, not otherwise. And the activity of the spirit must take exactly the reverse direction towards the outside, because the intuitional brain alone has the ability to absorb spiritual impressions. The ponderer, however, clings convulsively to the impression of an outward happening in his intellectual frontal brain. There he dissects and analyzes it, and does not pass it on to the intuitional brain in its full value, but only partly. In addition, these parts are distorted through excessive intellectual activity, and thus it is no longer as real as it was. For this reason there can be no progress for him, no spiritual maturing, which can only come about through the real experiencing of outward happenings. Be like children in this. Absorb everything fully and experience it immediately within yourselves. Then it will again stream back through the intuitional brain to the intellectual brain. From there it can either serve for a strong and successful defense, or increase the receptive capacity, depending on the nature of the outward happenings, the radiations of which are called influences or impressions from without. Man will receive his training for this during the millennium, which shall become the kingdom of peace and happiness, the kingdom of God on earth. Owing to his exacting desires, man again misunderstands what this means, because in his conceit he can no longer form anything in the right and healthy way. The expression, the kingdom of God on earth, calls forth a tremulous joy in the ranks of all those hoping for it. They really think of it as a gift of joy and happiness, which will fully correspond to their longing for tranquil enjoyment. Actually, however, it will be a time of the strictest obedience for all mankind. Today, nobody is willing to accept the fact that therein lies a demand that man's volition and desires must at last completely subordinate themselves to the will of God. Peace and happiness will then ensue because all disturbing elements will be forcibly removed from the earth, and will be kept away from it in the future. To these, in the first place, belongs the man of today, for he alone caused the disturbances in creation and here on earth. But after a certain hour has struck, no disturbing one will be able to live on this earth any longer. This will come about through the transforming of the radiations, which takes place through the star of the Son of Man. Peace will be enforced, not come as a gift, and to keep the peace will then be demanded, firmly and relentlessly. Such will be the kingdom of peace and happiness, the kingdom of God on earth, in which man must be deprived of ruling by his volition, which he was permitted to keep hitherto. For being spiritual among the developed ones upon this earth, he must, as the highest creature, therefore rule in strict accordance with the primordial laws of creation. In future there will only be able to exist that man and all those creatures which voluntarily adjust themselves to the will of God. Those which live and think and work accordingly. This alone offers the possibility to live in the coming millennium. Voluntary martyrs, religious fanatics. Men who voluntarily inflict pain and privation upon themselves in order to become pleasing to God are repulsive. None of them will ever attain to the kingdom of heaven. Instead of showing gratitude for their existence by enjoying the beautiful creation, they torment and torture their bodies, which before were often quite healthy, in the most wanton manner, or harm them by various self-imposed privations and renunciations, only in order to be considered great in the eyes of men, or to achieve personal satisfaction and exaltation, under the delusion that they have accomplished quite an exceptional feat. All this is nothing but an evil and obnoxious outgrowth of the most gross and base conceit, the desire by every means and at all costs to pass for something before others. Generally, such persons fully realize that they can never command attention in any other way, thereby clearly perceiving their inability to distinguish themselves by achieving something great. They have become convinced of their insignificance. In their self-delusion, they consider this conviction as to their insignificance to be humility. But it is not humility, and they immediately prove it by their desire to attract attention. Only self-complacency and vanity drive them to such repugnant acts. These are not pious ones or humble servants of God, nor should they be considered saints, but only willful sinners. Sinners who even expect to be admired for their sins and to be rewarded for their indolent attitude towards work. If it never dawns upon many of them that this is a great sin, because in striving for self-exaltation, they themselves do not wish to recognize it as such, this does not alter the fact that ultimately every action remains always and only what it really is, and not what man wishes to make himself and others believe it is. Such men are nothing but sinners before God, because by their willful or stubborn behavior they oppose his primordial laws of creation. They do not give the bodies entrusted to them the necessary nourishment and care, in order to develop that strength which will enable them to provide a strong soil for the spirit on earth, and to make healthy and vigorous tools for defense and reception, serving the spirit powerfully, both as shield and as sword at the same time. Willfully to oppose the laws of nature in order to stand out and attract attention is nothing but the result of a diseased brain. For a healthy man will never imagine that he can change or improve the will of God expressed in the primordial laws of creation, even by as much as a hair's breadth, without harming himself. How foolish, how childishly wayward or ridiculous does it appear when a man spends a lifetime in a hollow tree, when he allows a limb of his body to become completely paralyzed, or when he lacerates or defiles himself. Let man exert himself as he will to find a reason which would justify such behavior, or which would even offer some sense for it. It is and remains a crime against the body entrusted to him, and therefore a crime against the will of God. To these also belong the innumerable martyrs to vanity and fashion. Pay no further attention to such people. You will see how quickly they change, how shallow are their convictions. A fanatic ruins himself by his stubbornness. He is not worth grieving over, for such a human spirit never has any values to show. And just as thousands of people severely maltreat their physical bodies in this manner, therewith maliciously turning against the will of God, so is it also done in a thousand ways against the soul. Great is the number of those, for instance, who continually live under the self-imposed delusion that they are outcasts in the world, bereft of happiness, neglected by their fellow men, and so on. Yet they themselves make demands upon their fellow men which are far from justified. Their envy has a disintegrating effect upon their surroundings, whereby they heap an ever-growing and heavy burden of guilt upon their shoulders. These comprise the vermin which must be crushed underfoot in the judgment, so that undimmed peace, joy, and happiness may at last reign among men. However, not only do they torment their neighbours with their moods, but they also injure their own soul bodies in much the same way as religious fanatics harm their physical bodies. In so doing, they especially transgress against the divine laws, for they recklessly injure all those necessary cloaks which are entrusted to their spirit, so that they cannot be used by the spirit in their fresh health and full vigour. Far-reaching indeed are the consequences of such deeds on the part of those who thus abuse their physical or soul bodies. Their spirits are hampered and harmed in their urgent and necessary development, and may even be led into eternal disintegration, into perdition. But even as they fall, they will still suffer from the delusion that they are the victims of injustice. Basically, however, they are only contemptible creatures, unworthy to enjoy any happiness. Disregard and avoid them, therefore, for they do not merit even one good word. Servants of God. Without any reason to justify it, many people have hitherto assumed that servants of churches, temples, and religious movements in general must also be regarded as the equivalent of servants of God. This idea was disseminated at the time of the founding and development of all sorts of cults by the servants of these cults, who thereby sought to gain respect for themselves, which they would hardly have been able to achieve personally. And it has been retained ever since, without anybody attempting to realize the fact that this is harmful instead of beneficial to mankind, and most important of all, that it leads to a wrong conception of God. A man standing in creation with an alert spirit, one who does not remain closed to the delicate intuitive vibrations of his soul, will never be able to accept as true that the great and living God can really be served through the practices of cults, through the begging that men call praying, or through mortification of the flesh. With these practices you do not give anything to your God. You do not offer him anything. What, then, is your real aim? You yourselves do not know how to answer this question when you stand before the judgment seat of God. You will have to remain silent, for you have done all this only for yourselves, for your inner composure and exaltation, or in despair and affliction. But I say unto you, only that man who stands aright in the creation of his God, who recognizes himself as a part of creation and lives accordingly, only he is the true servant of God, no matter in what way he earns his necessary living on earth. As a part of creation, he will always strive to adjust himself to those laws that have a furthering effect therein. Thus he himself furthers creation, and serves his God in the only right way. For through the right adjustment, only happiness, joy, and further progress can arise. For this reason he must naturally become familiar with creation. And this is something you badly need, to recognize the will of God resting in creation, and its constant, self-acting effects therein. But so far you have never troubled yourselves to do just this in the correct manner. And yet it is the same for all of you, namely that you stand and must move in the midst of a mighty mechanism, so to speak, without ever being able to alter or improve upon it. Unless you stand and move in it aright, however, danger threatens you from all sides. You are sure to hit yourselves, and may fall and be torn to pieces. Exactly as in a gigantic machine shop, with numerous driving belts constantly moving in all directions, confusing the eye, and seriously threatening at every step all those not acquainted with it, but only of real service and use to the expert. It is no different for man in creation. At last learn to understand its mechanism aright. Then you may and shall use it for your own happiness. But to do this you must first become an apprentice, as in everything. The greatest of all works, this creation, is no exception. The same applies here as with all men's productions. Even an automobile gives pleasure only to the expert. It brings death, however, to him who does not know how to control it. There are thousands of such minor examples available to you. Why have you never learned anything from them as yet? All this may be recognized in such a simple and natural way. But just in this matter you stand as if before a wall, apathetic, indifferent, and with an inexplicable stubbornness. After all, it is your life, your entire existence, which is at stake here. Only the constructor himself can explain the working of a machine to you, or a man whom he has trained for the task. It is the same in creation as here on earth. But it is just in regard to creation that men who are themselves only a part of it imagine that they of themselves know everything better than their master, and refuse to be trained in the use of the mechanism. They themselves want to teach the basic laws, which they try to establish through superficial observation of the very faint, last ramifications of what is great and true, to the perception of which they always kept themselves closed. Thus there can never be any question of knowledge. And yet the possibility of recognition was already lovingly offered to you by the Son of God, who tried to teach you through parables and pictures. However, their meaning was not grasped, but instead, by insisting that they knew better, men badly distorted, darkened, and perverted it. Now again you are granted the opportunity clearly to see the laws of God in creation, so that men may become true servants of God, fully conscious and in joyous and cheerful activity, as the true worship of God requires. Joy and happiness can exist in all creation. You men alone bring about distress and sorrow, disease and crime, for right up to the present day, you did not want to recognize the source of the vast power which was given to you for your journey through all the worlds, in which by your own desire you must all wander for your development. If only you adjust yourselves aright, this power will forcibly bring sunshine and happiness into your lives. Unless you do this, you stand small and helpless in the all-embracing mechanism, yet still boasting with big words of yourselves and your knowledge, until finally you must fall through these faults, which arose only out of your ignorance and unwillingness to learn anything. Wake up at last. First start learning in order to acquire the knowledge, otherwise you will never make any progress. In the eyes of the Creator, you are now far less than an insect. An insect faithfully fulfills its allotted task, while you as human spirits fail. you fail through your vain pseudo-knowledge that is no knowledge. Your schools, founded on this sham knowledge, are fetters that hold you firmly bound, even choking every attempt at spiritual ascent, because the teachers in these schools cannot set about this spiritual ascent themselves. Thank the Lord that the possibility of continuing to live on such an empty and thoroughly detrimental basis will now be forcibly taken from you. Otherwise you would never recognize the contemptibleness surrounding you everywhere today, which must bring ridicule upon you throughout creation for being empty, grotesquely dressed up dolls, whose spirits are asleep within them. The instinct of animals. Men are often struck with admiration when they observe the instinctive actions of animals. They ascribe a special sense to animals, which mankind either lack completely, or which they have allowed to degenerate. They are perplexed, for example, when they see a horse, a dog, or some other animal suddenly refusing to pass a certain place on a road it is accustomed to, and which it has perhaps taken daily, and when they subsequently learn that an accident occurred on that very spot shortly afterwards. Quite often the lives of one or more persons have been saved through such incidents. So many of these cases have been published that there is no need to go into the matter more deeply here. Instinct or unconscious presentiment are the terms man has used to describe this characteristic of the animal. Having found a name for a thing, men are usually well satisfied. They envisage something in their imagination and accept it as fact, irrespective of whether they are right or wrong. It is the same with this. The reason for such actions on the part of an animal, however, is quite a different one. It possesses neither the quality nor the ability of instinct as man understands the word. In such incidents, it merely heeds a warning that is given to it. These warnings can be seen quite well by the animal, whereas only a few people are able to observe them. As I have already explained in one of my earlier lectures, the soul of an animal does not originate in the spiritual sphere from which man comes, but from the animistic sphere. The elemental beings also originate there, such as the gnomes, elves, nixies, and so on, whose field of activity lies in what men usually call nature, that is, water, air, earth, and fire. The same applies to other beings which occupy themselves with the development and growth of stones, plants, and the like. All these elemental beings originate in another section of the animistic sphere to that of the animal souls. However, the mutual homogeneity of their origin provides a greater possibility for them to recognize each other. Thus, an animal is far better equipped to recognize these elemental beings than is man, whose origin lies in the spiritual sphere. The elemental beings know exactly when and where sudden changes in nature are about to take place, such as landslides, rocks being dislodged from mountains, trees falling, the caving in of land undermined by water, the bursting of a dam, sudden water eruptions, volcanic and fire eruptions, tidal waves and floods, earthquakes, and everything else coming within the same category, because they themselves are occupied with the preparation and bringing about of such changes, which men call disasters and catastrophes. If such a happening is imminent, it may well be that an animal or a person approaching the spot is warned by these elementals. They block the way, and try through vehement motions, shouting, or sudden impressions upon their feelings, to induce them to return. The animal is startled, its hair bristles, and it energetically refuses to continue, quite contrary to its usual behavior, so that often, as an exception, even the best-trained animal disobeys its master. This is the reason for the striking behavior of the animal in such cases. Man, however, does not see these elemental beings, and very often runs into the danger, thereby perishing or suffering great harm. For this reason, man should pay more attention to animals, so that he learns to understand them. Then animals will truly become man's friends, able to fill gaps, and thus be much more useful to him than they have been in the past. The kiss of friendship. There has been much discussion on this subject all over the world. Both in poetry and prose, the kiss of friendship has been beautified and exalted to a high position in the world of thoughts. However, all this is only a fantasy, far removed from what is natural. It is a pretty little cloak, which, as with so many things, Earthman has manufactured in order to admire himself or others in it. Yet admiration is absolutely out of place, for in reality it is nothing but hypocrisy, a shameful attempt to disarrange and distort the laws of creation, and thus divest them of their glorious and simple naturalness. It is true that the intention behind a kiss often varies, but this does not alter the fact that each kiss as such remains a kiss, that is, a physical contact, which according to the natural laws causes a feeling that can never be other than merely physical. He who knows my message is aware of this already. Man must not always behave in such a cowardly manner in his efforts to deny the true nature of his deeds. On the contrary, he must remain clearly conscious of them at all times. A hypocrite is even worse than an evildoer. The term kiss of friendship definitely presupposes the age of maturity. The kiss between a man and a woman who have reached a mature age, however, is subject to the vibrations of the primordial laws in creation, no matter how pure their intentions. It is ridiculous to make excuses. Man knows very well that the laws of nature do not ask for his opinion. The kiss given by a friend, a brother, or a father to a mature girl or woman always remains a kiss between the different sexes, despite the strongest self-delusion. It is no different with the kiss given by a mother to her son, as soon as he has reached a mature age. The laws of nature neither know of nor grant any distinction in these matters. Every person must therefore practice much greater self-restraint. Only man's mania for wishing to adapt the natural laws to his own desires creates ideas so opposed to those laws, such as kisses of friendship, embracing among relatives, and the many other trespasses existing in these matters. Under the most hypocritical cloaks, man often tries to sin even deliberately. Because many people believe they are acting quite harmlessly with such transgressions, and imagine their intentions to be absolutely pure, this does not alter the fact that such behavior is contrary to the laws of nature. It is and remains a distortion of the purest laws of nature when they are robbed of their beautiful simplicity by false interpretation. Only what is unhealthy arises from this, because every abuse and distortion only devalues, defiles and debases the original soundness of the law. Therefore, away with such hypocrisy. At last, honor the laws of nature as they really are, in their simple and thus sublime greatness. Adjust yourselves to them and live accordingly. Also adjust all your thinking, your actions and your habits to them, both within your families and outside. Therefore become natural in the purest sense, and you will then also be happy. Every unhealthy aspect of life will then fall away from you. Honesty will be the rule among you, and you will be spared many unnecessary inner conflicts, which only result from such foolish illusions and often molest and torment you all through your earthly lives. The unhealthiness of this injurious toying, this wrongful caressing, which invariably indicates a purely physical basis, can be most clearly observed in immature and guileless children of a tender age. Children who are continually showered with, or to put it quite frankly, molested by these family caresses, always have an unhealthy appearance. Besides, nearly every child shows an intuitive repulsion against such obtrusive fondling, and never any desire for it, because in reality a child is naturally innocent. To start with, it must first always be trained to tolerate and return caresses. Such training, however, is only desired by the grown-ups, who through the maturity of their physical bodies instinctively feel the need for it, but it is not the wish of the child. All this shows clearly enough the dangerous coercion which is being insidiously brought to bear upon the child. Gradually, however, it gets accustomed to this fondling, and finally comes to desire it out of sheer habit, until the maturing body itself awakens in the instinct. Shame on a mankind who continually try to hide their base desires and personal weaknesses under a cloak of hypocrisy, or who act thoughtlessly in such matters. Man must know that genuine love is of the soul only. Everything else is merely instinct. Psychic love, however, has nothing to do with the physical body, nor has it any physical desires. For the separation between all the species in creation always remains complete. Spiritual is spiritual, psychic is psychic, and physical is and always remains only physical. When the physical body dies, not a single particle of the soul dies with it. This proves in all simplicity that everything stands on its own, that no intermingling occurs. A soulful kiss, for example, exists only in the imagination, because every kiss is and always remains merely a gross material act. What a man experiences in his soul thereby is an entirely separate matter. Psychic love goes beside the physical instinct, not with it, or even in it. Any other conception is a gross self-deception, because it does not correspond with the laws of nature. It was only the intellect which invented differences therein to serve as an excuse, and in order to create a new caricature with which to mutilate the truth. In its pure form, the truth should bring mankind to awakening and recognition, thus to purity and truthfulness of character, and finally to ascent towards the light. Now at last, man, have the courage to be true in all you do. Also in regard to the kiss. Break through the deceptive images your vanity and sensual lust have created. Wake up! The distorted tool. The greatest burden with which the human soul has encumbered itself, and which will hinder every possibility of ascent, is vanity. It has spread ruin throughout the entire creation. Vanity has become the most powerful poison for the soul, because man has cherished it as a shield and mask for all his shortcomings. Like a narcotic, it always helps to overcome psychic shocks easily. It is of no consideration to earthmen that this is merely an illusion, so long as it affords them satisfaction, and therewith the possibility to attain some earthly goal, if only a few minutes of ridiculous self-complacency. It does not need to be genuine. A mere semblance will suffice. People speak of this vanity, of conceit, spiritual arrogance, malicious joy, and so many characteristics of all earthmen, in a benevolent and glossing over way, as being snares of the Lucifer principle. All this, however, is nothing but feeble self-excuse. Lucifer had no need whatever to exert himself so very much. It sufficed for him to tempt man to enjoy the fruit of the tree of knowledge, and thus to indulge in the knowledge, thereby inducing him to overdevelop his intellect. All that followed was brought about by man himself. As the worst outgrowth of the intellect, which is earthbound and gaining the upper hand, vanity must be disposed of. Vanity, which is the root of so many evils, such as envy, hatred, slander, and the craving for all kinds of earthly pleasures and possessions. Everything that is ugly in this world is really anchored in vanity, which expresses itself in a great variety of ways. It was the urge towards outward sham which produced the caricature of man so predominant today. The sham being who does not deserve to be called man, because in his vanity he undermined the possibility of the necessary spiritual ascent for the sake of sham, stubbornly blocking all the natural connecting lines given to him for his activity and spiritual maturing, and wantonly burying them entirely against the Creator's will. The effect of raising the earthbound intellect to the position of an idol was in itself sufficient to change the entire course which the Creator had designed for man in his creation. Lucifer claimed it as a triumph for himself that the human soul had ventured to interfere with its physical body in such a manner as to make it utterly impossible for the soul to fulfill its willed activity in creation. In order to sharpen the intellect, man feverishly promoted the one-sided cultivation of that part of the brain which is exclusively devoted to working in the world of gross matter, namely the frontal brain. This resulted in the automatic repression and curtailment of the activity of the spiritually receiving part of the human brain. Consequently, the ability to comprehend spiritual things was rendered more difficult, and in the course of thousands of years, Earthman even entirely lost spiritual understanding. Thus he now stands forsaken and useless in creation, cut off from the possibility of spiritual recognition and ascent, and consequently also cut off from God. That is the work of Lucifer. He had no need to do anything more. He could then leave Earthman to himself, watching him sink from one step to another, and thus remove himself further and further from God, all as a consequence of this single act. For those men who make the genuine effort to think objectively just for once, it is not at all difficult to observe this. It is easily understandable that intellectual activity also bears within itself the conceit which comes of an insistence on knowing better, the obstinate perseverance in everything which such activity considers right. For man has thought as far as he was able to think in these matters. He has reached his highest limit in thinking. Man cannot know that this limit is a low one because of the earthbound condition of his frontal brain, and that therefore he cannot penetrate any further with his intellect. For this reason he will always believe and aver that with his limit he has also achieved what is right. If he hears something different, he will always give greater credence to and consider right what he has thought out. This remains the peculiarity of every intellect, and thus of all intellectuals. As I have already pointed out once, it is the task of one portion of the brain substance to receive what is spiritual like an antenna, while the other portion, which produces the intellect, transforms what has been received for use in the gross material world. Conversely, the frontal brain, which produces the intellect, is likewise supposed to take in all the impressions from the world of matter, and so transform them that the back brain can receive them and use them for the further development and maturing of the spirit. Both parts, however, are intended to work together, for it has been so decreed by the Creator. Due to the intervention caused by the one-sided cultivation of the frontal brain, the latter became over-dominating in its activity, thus disturbing the necessary harmonious cooperation between the two brains, and consequently all healthy activity in creation. The development of the portion meant to receive spiritual impressions lagged behind, while the frontal brain, which became more and more active through training, had long since ceased to receive through the back brain the pure vibrations from luminous heights necessary for its work and for transmission into the world of gross matter. Instead, it absorbs its working substance for the most part from its material environment and from thought forms only, which it sends out again remodeled as its own production. There are only a few people today whose receptive portion of the brain cooperates harmoniously, at least to some extent, with the frontal brain. These people rise above the ordinary level, and distinguish themselves through great inventions, or through an amazing reliability in their capacity to perceive intuitively, which enables them quickly to grasp many things that can only be attained by others through laborious study. These are the people of whom it is enviously said that they receive it in their sleep. They confirm the saying, "The Lord gives it to his own in their sleep." By his own are meant those who still use their implements in accordance with the Creator's decree, that is, those who are what he wills them to be, and who, like the wise virgins, continually replenished the oil in their lamps. For these alone can recognize the bridegroom when he comes. Only they are really awake. All the others are asleep in their self-imposed limitations. They rendered themselves incapable of recognizing, because they did not keep the requisite tools in proper order. Without the harmonious cooperation of that portion of the brain meant to receive spiritual impressions, the frontal brain is like a lamp without oil. Persons of mediumistic ability cannot so easily be included in the above category. While it is true that the receptive part of their brain necessarily functions more or less well, during this receptive activity, the frontal brain of such mediums, which is meant for the earthly transmission of what is received, becomes fatigued. Due to the determined volition of some dweller in the beyond, the proceedings bring exceptional pressure to bear upon the receptive portion of the medium's brain, and this consequently calls for a more powerful counter-pressure, which in turn automatically draws blood from the frontal brain, that is, the warmth which is engendered by movement, with the result that the frontal brain comes to a partial or complete standstill. It cooperates only sluggishly, or not at all. This withdrawal of blood would not be necessary if the receptive brain had not been seriously weakened by the suppression. This gives the cause why the transmission of a medium, either verbally or in writing, does not appear to be so well remodeled for earthly comprehension as it must necessarily be if it is to be correctly understood by earthly conceptions, such as computation of space and time. This also gives the cause why mediums who often foresee earthly events, catastrophes or the like, can rarely in their utterances or writings forecast the earthly time accurately. A medium receives the ethereal impression and passes it on verbally or in writing with little or no alteration at all for the gross material world. This naturally results in misunderstanding on the part of those who view things from a purely gross material standpoint. The ethereal impression differs from the gross material effect which manifests later on. For in the world of ethereal matter, the contrasts are sharper and richer, with corresponding effects. Now it frequently happens that mediums depict nothing but ethereal things without alteration, because the frontal brain cannot follow up with its work of remodeling and is quiescent. Then the picture of an event and the times given differ, for ethereal conceptions of time also differ from earthly conceptions. Consequently, predictions and descriptions of the same happening will sound different from almost every mediumistic person, depending on the degree of cooperation possible by their frontal brain, which can only in very rare cases achieve the complete transformation necessary for earthly conceptions. If those dwelling in the beyond, however, are striving to re-establish connection between the world of ethereal matter and the world of gross matter, which had been severed by earthmen, then no exactions or ridiculously presumptuous judgments on the part of ignoramuses and intellectuals shall be further tolerated, for such efforts must be taken with absolute seriousness, so that what has been spoiled by conceited vanity can again be restored. All fantastics, zealots, and mystics must also be excluded from participating, for in reality they are even more detrimental than the intellectuals. If both parts of the brain of earthmen could cooperate harmoniously, as the Creator ordained they should, then the transmissions of the mediums would be given in conceptions of time suitable to the world of gross matter. As it is, however, the more or less extensive withdrawal of blood from the frontal brain causes derangements and distortions. To correct them requires diligent study through observation. But it deserves neither the ridicule nor the aspersion of fraudulent intentions, such as the spiritually indolent love to suggest. As in all fields, so also in this, there will naturally always be people with a pretense to knowledge, who bask in their proficiency in these things, and who make themselves completely ridiculous, not to mention others with sordid aims. But such can be found everywhere, and it affords no justification for besmirching the work itself, or those seriously engaged upon it in such a flagrant manner. This kind of conduct, which disparages everything that cannot yet be understood, is again nothing but an expression of ridiculous vanity, a sign of irresponsible stupidity which has become habitual among these people. But there is nothing that is great or sublime which has not in the beginning incurred the enmity of mankind. Not excluding the utterances of Christ Jesus, who fared no differently himself. Such scoffers show only too clearly that they go through life blindfolded, or at least with obvious narrow-mindedness. Let us take a glance around us. He who goes on his way scoffing at the previsions and forecasts of terrible happenings which accumulate from all sides, and who refuses to see that many of them are already being fulfilled, that natural catastrophes are increasing from one week to the next, is either narrow-minded or does not yet want to recognize anything because of a certain fear. These are the narrow-minded or cowardly who dare not face the facts. In any case, they are harmful creatures. He who does not yet wish to recognize the great economic distress which steadily increases in every country on earth, nor see in the consequent confusion and helplessness a disastrous setback, just because he himself still happens to have enough to eat and drink, such a person no longer deserves to be called man, for he must be inwardly corrupt and blunted to the suffering of others. All this has already happened before. That is what they thoughtlessly reply. It is true that such events have taken place before, but singly, and not in the same conditions as today, not with all this knowledge men boast of, and with all the precautionary measures which can now be taken. That is as different as day is from night. Above all, there was never such an accumulation of events. In past times, a gap of years occurred between natural catastrophes. Such happenings excited all civilized nations and were talked and written about for months, while today they are dismissed from the mind within a few hours at a dance or in everyday conversation. This is a difference which people do not want to see, on account of a fear which manifests itself in frivolity, in a wanton refusal to understand. The people must not be disturbed. That is the order which has gone forth. Not out of love for humanity, however, but only for fear that mankind might make demands with which no one could cope any longer. The attempts made to calm the public are often so crude that none but the indifferent humanity, with that obtuseness that prevails today, can listen to them in silence. Nobody bothers to recognize and remonstrate against these efforts as being antagonistic to the sublime will of God. God wills that men should recognize these warnings, which speak so plainly to them in the march of events. They are meant to awaken out of their irresponsible spiritual lethargy, in order to reflect and retrace their steps in time, before it becomes necessary that they themselves must experience all the afflictions they can still see their fellow men suffering. It is rebellion against God on the part of those who try to prevent this with comforting words. Unfortunately, however, mankind are only too susceptible to every word which tends to absolve them from personal spiritual activity. Hence they like to listen to the most peculiar utterances, accept them faithfully, and in fact desire to have them, even spread and advocate them, rather than be disturbed from their peace and comfort. And beloved vanity beats time to this, proving the best support of all those weeds which, like vanity itself, grow as the fruit of the intellectual domination which is hostile to God. Vanity will never permit the recognition of the truth, no matter where it is to be found. What it achieves in this respect is proved by the attitude of this mankind to the life on earth of the Son of God, which in its true and great simplicity does not satisfy the vain minds of men. The believer wants his Saviour only in accordance with his own ideas. Therefore he embellishes the earthly mission of the Son of God, Christ Jesus, with events of his own fabrication. According to man's opinion, and solely because of his humility towards all that is divine, this Saviour, being the Son of God, must also be absolutely supernatural. But in so thinking they do not realize that God himself is the perfection of all that is natural, and that creation developed out of this his perfect naturalness through his will. Perfection, however, also bears the unchangeable within itself. If there could possibly be an exception in the laws of creation which correspond with the will of God, they would be bound to contain a gap, and thus lack perfection. Man's humility, however, sets itself above all this. For as regards the life of the Son of God on earth, it expects, even demands, an alteration in the existing laws in creation, thus a trespass against them. And just from him who had come to fulfill all the laws of his Father, as he himself said. They expect from him things which must simply be impossible according to the laws of natural development. And just by that is his divinity to manifest itself, the divine which carries the living source of the natural laws within itself. Yes, man's humility can achieve a great deal, but its true face bears the stamp of exaction, and not of genuine humility. The greatest presumption and the worst form of spiritual arrogance. Sweet vanity just covers this with a thin cloak which bears a semblance of humility. It is indeed sad that so often even those who have a really good volition allow themselves, in their initial and quite genuine humility, unwittingly to be carried away by their enthusiasm, to commit the most incredible things. They gave play to their imagination, and the subsequent transmissions did great harm. Thus the child Jesus was already supposed to have performed the greatest miracles, even during the childhood games, played by every child who is healthy and spiritually alert. The small birds which he modelled from ordinary clay came to life and flew into the air singing merrily, and many other such things. Such happenings are simply impossible, because they are contrary to all the divine laws in creation. Otherwise God the Father might just as well have placed his Son upon the earth as a fully mature man. What was the need of a human mother? Why the inconvenience of a birth? Are men unable to think in simple terms for once? It is their personal vanity which deters them. In their opinion, the life of the Son of God on earth must be different. They want it this way so that their Saviour and their Redeemer should not be subject to the laws of God in creation. Actually, in their view, this would not have been too small for him, the Son of God, but it surely would have been for all those who wish to recognize their Redeemer in him. Human vanity and nothing else. They failed to realize how even greater it was for Jesus voluntarily to subject himself to these laws by becoming flesh, in order to bring the truth in the words to those who, through the distortion of their earthly tool, had wantonly rendered themselves incapable of receiving and recognizing the truth of their own accord. They were much too conceited to see Christ's mission fulfilled in the word itself. For them, vain men that they are, greater things had to come to pass. And when the Son of God suffered physical death upon the cross, dying just as any man must die when crucified, because it corresponds with the divine laws in creation, when his human body could not simply descend unharmed from the cross, then vanity had no other choice but to assert that the Son of God had to die in this way, that in order to bear the sins of the poor little men, he did not wish to step down from the cross, so that they can now be joyfully received into the kingdom of heaven. And thus the foundation was laid for the later belief in the necessity of the death on the cross, that great and tragic error prevalent among Christians today, which is entirely due to the vanity of men. If there is no longer any man who wishes to recognize that such thinking can only arise out of shameless conceit, to the joy of Lucifer, who presented man with vanity in order to ruin him, then there is no longer any help for humanity, and all is in vain. Even the greatest and strongest warnings in nature cannot arouse them from their spiritual sleep. Why does not man think any further? If it would have been possible for Christ to have risen from the dead in the flesh, then it follows that one could just as logically expect it to be possible for him to descend to the earth, already matured in the flesh, from that sphere to which he was supposed to have ascended physically at his resurrection. That this did not happen, however, that on the contrary, from the very beginning he had to live through the phases that every human body is subject to from birth onwards, with all their great and minor troubles, and also face the many other needs of his earthly life, clearly enough speaks against this conception. Quite apart from the fact that it could not be otherwise, because the Son of God also had to submit himself to the perfect laws of his Father in creation. He who wishes to enter creation and live upon the earth is subject to the immutable laws of creation. All assertions to the contrary are inventions, created in their enthusiasm by men themselves, and then bequeathed as the truth. The same happened with all traditions, regardless of whether they were passed on verbally or in writing. Human vanity plays a great role in this. Very seldom indeed do they issue from the human hand, voice, or even brain without something being added. Second-hand records never constitute a proof on which posterity should rely. Man only needs to observe current events closely. Let us take just one example which received worldwide publicity. Newspapers in all countries published reports of the mysterious castle on Vomperberg, of which I was supposed to be the owner. I was described as the Messiah of the Tyrol, or the Prophet of Vomperberg, with great and prominent headlines, even in the leading newspapers which wished to be taken seriously. There were weird and mysterious accounts of numerous underground tunnels, of temples, of knights both in black and silver armor, of an unheard-of cult, also of great parks, automobiles, stables, and whatever else could be invented by the diseased brains that can report such things. Details were quoted, some based on beautiful fantasy, and others so disgustingly filthy that anyone giving a little thought to the matter could not fail immediately to recognize the lies and malevolence behind it. And there was not one word of truth in any of these reports. If, however, after centuries, or better still, in thousands of years to come, some person reads one of these evil and scurrilous articles, who can blame him for wanting to believe it, and saying, here it is, reported and published, and the same in nearly every newspaper and language? And all this was nothing but a reflection of the decadent brains of this time. With their own works they stamp themselves with the proof of their depravity, ready for the coming judgment. This happened even today, in spite of every facility for speedily obtaining accurate information before publication. What must it have been like in former times, in the days of Jesus, when everything could only be passed on by word of mouth? How greatly subject to alteration are such verbal transmissions? This applies equally to written records and letters. It takes on the characteristics of an avalanche. Already partially misunderstood at the start, in this way there always arises something different to the original facts. How much of what has been heard has been written down at second, third, or even tenth hand only, but which has now come to be regarded as the original basis? Surely men should know their fellow men. As soon as they can no longer make use of the scaffolding of their intellect, which is the case with all truth on account of its great simplicity, they are not satisfied. They either reject or change it in a manner that suits their beloved vanity. For this reason, mysticism is preferred to the simple truth. The great craving for mysticism, for everything mysterious, which is ingrained within every person, is vanity, and not the urge for truth as is so often depicted. Self-complacency constructed the unhealthy way upon which hosts of idle enthusiasts can sun themselves, and upon which many who are spiritually indolent allow themselves leisurely to drift. In all these matters the vanity of man plays a devastating and dismal role, dragging him tenaciously and irretrievably down to destruction, because he has come to love it. He would be seized with consternation if he could but once master himself sufficiently to reflect about it objectively and without self-complacency. But again, that is just the difficulty. He cannot do anything without being self-complacent. Thus, many will probably have to remain in this state until they perish from it. This fact in all its tragedy is the result which, consequent upon the fall of man, was forcibly brought about by the prevention of the harmonious development of the brain in the earthly body entrusted to him. the distortion of the tool indispensable to man in this gross material world, through its one-sided development, has thereby exacted its revenge. Now man stands unharmoniously in creation, with his gross material tool, his physical body, incapable of performing the task he has to fulfill therein, rendered useless by himself. To eradicate the root of all this evil, the intervention of God is necessary. Every other power and authority, however great, is inadequate to achieve this. It constitutes the greatest and most devastating contamination in man's false volition that ever found its way into creation. Everything on this earth will have to collapse before any improvement can come about, because there is nothing in existence which is not already irretrievably pervaded by it. The child. When people ask themselves what is the right way to bring up their children, they must first of all consider and adjust themselves to the particular child. The personal wishes of the educator in this matter must be put completely aside. The child must go its own way on earth, but not that of its educator. It is well meant if an educator sincerely wishes to put at the disposal and use of his child those experiences which he himself had to undergo in his life on earth, with a view to sparing the child much in the way of disappointment, loss, and pain. But in most cases he achieves very little. In the end he has to recognize that all his efforts and good intentions in this matter have been utterly in vain, for at a certain time the maturing child quite suddenly and unexpectedly goes its own way, and in decisions of importance to itself has forgotten or disregarded all admonitions. The educator is not justified in bewailing this, for with all his good volition, he entirely failed to realize that the child he wished to educate has by no means to follow in his footsteps, in order properly to fulfill the purpose of its existence here on earth. All the experiences which the educator could or was obliged to undergo in the past were intended and necessary for him. They were therefore only of use to him, provided he was capable of absorbing them in the right manner. The experiences of the educator, however, cannot bring the same benefits to the child, because for the purpose of its own development, the child's spirit must pass through entirely different experiences that accord with the threads of fate connected with it. Not two of the many men on earth follow the same path for the purpose of furthering their spiritual maturing. The experiences of one man are therefore spiritually valueless for any other man. And if one person exactly follows and imitates the footsteps of another, he has just frittered away his own time on earth. Until the child reaches maturity, you shall only prepare the tool which it needs for its life on earth, and nothing else, namely the physical body with all its gross material functions. Exercise the greatest care to see that you do not distort or even completely disable it through excesses or one-sidedness. Next to the necessary physical training, schooling in the right activity of its brains plays an important part. The first period of this training ends with the beginning of maturity, and not until then must the second period begin, which is to teach the spirit to control the entire body correctly. Until the spirit breaks through in the years of their maturity, the children of earthmen have only a predominantly animistic intuitive perception. Naturally, they are already set aglow inwardly by the spirit. That is, they are not merely like noble animals in the highest state of development, but already very much more. Nevertheless, the animistic prevails and is therefore decisive. It is absolutely imperative that this be borne in mind by every educator, and the basis of an education strictly adjusted in accordance with it, if the result is to become complete and without harmful effects on the child. The child must first receive full understanding in the great activity of all that is animistic, to which at this time it is still more open than to that which is spiritual. In this way its eyes will open in joy and purity to the beauties of nature which it sees around it. The streams, the mountains, the forests, the meadows, and the flowers, as well as the animals, will then become familiar to every child, who will be securely anchored in this realm, which is to provide the field of activity during its sojourn on earth. It will then stand quite firmly and fully conscious in nature, in the whole world of animistic activity, full of understanding, and thus well equipped and quite ready to work with its spirit also, uplifting and furthering to an even greater extent all that surrounds it like a huge garden. Only thus can it become a true gardener in creation. On this basis and not otherwise must each maturing child stand when the spirit breaks through, healthy in body and soul, joyfully developed and prepared on that soil to which every child belongs. The brain must not be one-sidedly overburdened with things that will never be needed during its life on earth, things which do cost great pains to acquire, consequently wasting its strength and weakening body and soul. If, however, a preliminary education already takes all his strength, then man has nothing left for his real task. With the right training and preparation for real life, however, work becomes only a joy, a pleasure, for then everything in creation is also able to vibrate in full harmony, thus supporting the maturing of youth by furthering and strengthening it. But how senselessly men act towards their children! What crimes are they guilty of against posterity? Just when the spirit within the young girl's body breaks forth, so that it can make use of the gross material and ethereal tools entrusted and given to it, in order that she may become a real human being, this young representative of womanhood is dragged off to earthly pleasures, with the idea of getting her quickly linked up with a man. The spirit, the true human being, which has yet to face earthly activity, thus never gets a start. Becoming paralyzed, it must watch how the earthly intellect, which was exclusively and wrongly trained, expends itself in nothing but glittering nonsense in order to appear clever and witty, and thus cover the lack of true spirit. It must observe how the intellect becomes implicated in all sorts of impossible things, thereby requiring and squandering the entire strength the tool is able to give. Finally, the woman becomes a mother, without ever having been a real human being. Thus there is no field left for the spirit, no possibility for it to become active. And things are not much better for the young man. He is weary and fatigued from overburdening study in schools, his nerves overwrought. He provides only a diseased soil for the spirit breaking through, a brain distorted by and satiated with useless things. Thus the spirit cannot work as it should, and in turn cannot develop itself properly, but is stunted and completely smothered by the weight of the dross. There only remains an unquenchable yearning to give some inkling as to the presence of the immured and suppressed human spirit. Finally, even this longing is lost in the mad whirl of earthly haste and greed, which is first meant to act as a bridge over this spiritual vacuum, and which later on becomes a habit and a need. This is the manner in which man now goes through his earthly life. and for the most part the faulty upbringing is to blame for it. If man wishes to stand aright here on earth, the first part of his training, that is, of his education, must absolutely be changed. Let children really be children in these matters. Never allow them to enjoy equal privileges with grown-ups, nor indeed expect that grown-ups should adjust themselves to children. You are giving them a strong poison by doing so. For the spirit of the children has not yet broken through from within. They are still largely dominated by their animistic nature, and therefore they are not on a level with grown-ups. Children feel this very distinctly. Therefore, do not allow them to play a role which deprives them of this consciousness. You only make them unhappy. They become unsteady upon the firm soil of the childhood, which is their rightful due, and which is ordained for them in creation. But they can never feel at home on an equal footing with grown-ups, because they lack the principal quality which entitles them and makes them able to exist on that level, the complete connection of their spirits with the outer world through their bodies. You rob them of the genuine childhood to which they are fully entitled according to the laws of creation, and which they even need urgently, because the experiences of childhood are absolutely necessary for the later development of the spirit. Instead, you often allow them to mingle with grown-ups, in whose company they cannot move freely, since they lack every quality to do so. Such children become unsteady and precocious, which naturally only appears repulsive to grown-ups, giving an unhealthy impression, and disturbing pure intuition and all harmony. For a precocious child is like a fruit, the kernel of which is still unripe, whereas the shell is already about to grow old. Beware of this, parents and educators, for it is a crime against the laws of God. Let children remain as children. Children that know they are in need of the protection of all grown-ups. The task of the grown-up is only to furnish the protection which he is able and also in duty bound to give where the child deserves it. Unless you yourselves destroy this law of nature, the child in its animistic state quite distinctly senses the need of the grown-up's protection and consequently looks up to him, by way of balance, voluntarily showing him the respect which implies the desire for support. But in most cases you do destroy this law. You tear every child out of its quite natural intuitive perceiving through the false methods you apply to them, very often just to satisfy your own desires, since for the most part the child is a lovable plaything to you, which you wish to enjoy, and which you try to make prematurely intelligent, so that you may be proud of it. All this is of no benefit to the child, but only harmful. In the days of its youth, which must be considered as the first stage of its development, already starting with the earliest years, you have to fulfill more serious duties towards the child. Not your wishes, but the laws of creation must be the decisive factor in this matter. And the decree that every child must be a child in all things. A human being who has really been a child will grow up to give full value as an adult, but only then. And a normal child can be solely recognized by the fact that it has a genuine respect for grown-ups in its personal intuitive perception, which thus precisely corresponds to the law of nature. All this every child already bears within itself as a gift of God. It will develop this if you do not bury it. Therefore keep children away when grown-ups converse together, for they do not belong there. In this also they must always know that they are children, and as such not yet of full value, not yet matured for their work on earth. Much more is contained in these apparent trifles than you think today. They fulfill a basic law in creation, which you often disregard. Children, all of whom still stand predominantly in the animistic, are in need of this as an outward support, in accordance with the law of the animistic. Grown-ups must give protection to children. Therein lies more than the words alone indicate. But they must grant protection only where the child deserves it. Children must return something to balance this protection, so that they may already learn through experiencing that there must be equilibrium everywhere, and that therein lie harmony and peace. This also is demanded by the nature of the animistic. It is just this, however, which many parents and educators have often neglected, although it is the fundamental condition for a proper upbringing, if such is to be carried out in accordance with the primordial laws of creation. Everyone lacking the conception of unconditional equilibrium is bound to waver and fall, no matter whether sooner or later. And the consciousness of the unavoidable necessity of this conception must be hammered into the minds of children from their very first days, so that it becomes as much their own, as much a part of their flesh and blood, and as natural as the feeling for physical balance which they develop, and which is based on the same fundamental law. If this principle is carefully applied in all education, there will at last be free men who are pleasing to God. But just this most indispensable and main fundamental law in this creation was disregarded by men everywhere. Except for the sense of physical balance, this law is not observed and practiced in the field of education. This necessarily brings about one-sidedness of an unhealthy kind, causing every man to flounder about psychically on his course through creation, and continually to stumble and fall. It is sad that this intuitive sense of equilibrium is only accepted as necessary for all movements of the physical body, but does not receive the proper care, and is often altogether neglected in things psychical and spiritual. The child must be carefully guided in these matters by imposing external restrictions upon him from the first weeks. To neglect this brings about dreadful consequences for the entire existence of every human being through the law of reciprocal action. Just look around you. In the life of the individual, as well as in the family, in state activities, and in the attitude of the churches, indeed everywhere, there is a serious lack of consideration in this and only in this. And yet you find this law manifesting clearly everywhere, if only you wish to observe it. Even the physical body indicates it. You can find it in regards to food intake and waste elimination. Also, indeed, in the various kinds of food you eat if the body is to keep well. In the balance between work and rest in all its details. Quite apart from the aforementioned law of equilibrium, which enables every individual body to move, and only thus to become fit for its task on earth. This law also holds and sustains the entire world, for only through the balance of equilibrium can stars and globes pursue their respective courses and maintain themselves. And you, you little men in creation, no more than a speck of dust before the sublime Creator, you overthrow this law by refusing to heed and obey it fully. For a time it was possible for you to distort it, but now it jerks back into its original form, and in doing so it must hit you painfully. Out of this one fault has grown all the affliction which hits creation today. It is also the cause of dissatisfaction and rebellion within nations, where a proper balance is lacking on the one side. However, this is nothing but a continuation and development of those mistakes which the educators make in regards to youth. The new kingdom, the kingdom of God on earth, will create equilibrium, and with it a new generation. But before it can be understood, force will have to be used to bring about the right conception of equilibrium. It will bring it about forcibly by remodeling all that is distorted, a process which is already taking place, because all that is false and unhealthy must run itself to death, urged on by the invincible power and force of the light. Then will follow the gift of the true conception of all the primordial laws of creation. Strive to recognize them correctly already, and you will stand aright in this creation. This in turn will result in bringing you nothing but happiness and peace. Woman and her vocation. A heavy burden presses upon all earthly womanhood since the delusion was spread abroad that woman's main vocation is motherhood. Some people look upon girls who do not marry, and also upon women whose marriages are childless, with false pity, and frequently even with hidden malicious joy. The expression old maid or elderly spinster, which is really an honorable name, is frequently used with an undertone of mockery and a pitying shrug of the shoulders, as if marriage were the highest goal for woman on earth, indeed her absolute vocation. That this false opinion has gained a foothold and spread so devastatingly over thousands of years is one of the supreme achievements of Lucifer, who in aiming at the debasement of womanhood delivered the most crushing blow at true humanity. For look around you. The evil outgrowths of this false opinion have from the very start trained the thoughts of parents and girls to concentrate upon earthly security through marriage. Everything is directed towards this. Even a girl's education, all her thinking, all her speaking and all her activities from the days of her childhood until she has attained maturity. Then the opportunity is sought or offered, or if this fails, is even brought about by force, to make acquaintances with the final aim of marriage. It is thoroughly hammered into the girl that her life will be joyless unless she can go through it at the side of a husband, and that otherwise she will never be taken seriously. Wherever a member of the female sex turns, she sees the glorification of earthly love, with maternal bliss as its highest aim. Thus, due to artificial pressure, the idea is formed that every girl who cannot achieve this is to be pitied, and has partly wasted her time on earth. From the moment of her birth, all thoughts, all desires, and all plans are aimed at this, which is so deeply ingrained as to become a part of her very flesh and blood. But all this is a very clever move by Lucifer, with the purpose of debasing human womanhood. This constraint must now be removed from womanhood on earth, if they are to ascend. Only from the ruins of the present delusion can greatness and purity arise. The God-willed, noble womanhood could not unfold through this most cunning of Lucifer's plots against the human spirits, all of whom could originally have done nothing but strive towards the light, had they unerringly followed and submitted to the guidance of the primordial laws of creation. Become spiritual at last, you men, for you are of the Spirit. Recognize and also have the courage to accept the fact that maternal bliss, which was considered the highest goal and most sacred destiny of earthly womanhood, is rooted only in the animistic. Woman's most sacred vocation, however, lies much higher, lies in the spiritual. Not once did the thought occur to you that everything you have praised so far was merely meant for the earth, for for life on earth, with all its restrictions. For marriage and procreation exist only in the gross material part of this subsequent creation, whereas womanhood exists in all creation. This fact should give you cause to consider. But no, this was expecting too much of you. Just as in the case of wild animals, which you try gradually to drive into a carefully built and well-concealed path, which they cannot distinguish from the free and beautiful forest, but which leads them into captivity, so have you always driven your daughters only towards the one goal, towards the man, as if that was their main destiny. The delusion created by this false view was akin to placing barriers to right and left, which ultimately also prevented the poor children from thinking in any but this one direction. And many a girl escaped by suddenly embarking upon a marriage which she contracted with great reluctance, only because she refused to fall a miserable prey in her old age to the consequences of this wrong opinion, which hang like threatening swords over every girl's head. When in the first upheavals of a new epoch, youth wished to flee from this unhealthy situation, which, however, they had not recognized for what it really was, this merely indicated an inner contradiction, developing quite subconsciously, a rebellion of the spirit which had been hitherto so suppressed. Unfortunately, they slipped into something much worse, into the idea of free companionship, and thus also of companionate marriage. Although in a different form, yet it is basically still the same excrescence of Lucifer's idea aiming at the debasement of womanhood. No purity could arise therefrom, because the darkness lays a sinister spell upon everyone, holding them firmly in its grip and oppressing them continually. That which was false was bound to remain, even when it appeared in a different form. The stroke that will liberate true womanhood can now only come from on high. Mankind themselves are unable to achieve it, because they entangled and enslaved themselves too much. Neither laws nor new forms can help here any longer. Salvation lies only in an understanding of all the primordial laws of creation. At last you must accept the truth as it really is, and not as you imagined it to be, because you were so susceptible to Lucifer's promptings. Human womanhood was debased and dishonored by the thought that every woman is supposed to consider motherhood as the principal purpose of her existence. For she was thereby degraded and bound to the animistic. Lucifer had no need to do more than disseminate this idea, which was thus absorbed and gradually developed into the definite belief still dominating the human mind today, forcing it into the very direction that prevents the spirit from soaring upwards towards pure and luminous heights. Thus the dirty fists of the Luciferian henchmen oppress the whole of earthly womanhood. Away with them! Free yourselves now from the clutches that hold you down. For this belief alone has brought in its train everything which must dishonor woman. The beautiful little cloak of sacred motherhood, the high praise bestowed upon mother love, can never alleviate this pressure of the dark fists, nor make these black fists luminous. Listen to my words. Through this belief, Earth Woman was made into a mother animal. Wake up, you girls, you women, and you men, so that you may at last recognize the absolute horror of this idea. One of your sacred rights is at stake. Lucifer could well be proud of this achievement. I have already stated once before that through womanhood Lucifer sought to deliver the most crushing blow against real humanity, and alas, he succeeded only too well. Follow for yourselves the thought he has sown among you with great cunning and malice. He deceitfully flattered you with the thought that motherhood was woman's highest task. But to attain to motherhood, the earthly instinct is needed, and it is this latter which he wanted to place on a higher pedestal through the thought of motherhood, so that it would become the dominant factor and force the thinking of mankind on earth into one direction. A plan which was conceived with admirable cunning. He played upon your feelings as carefully as a first-class artiste plays upon his instrument, dangling motherhood and mother-love alluringly before your eyes as a shield for his intentions, so that you were unable to recognize what was lurking in the background. And he succeeded completely. You heard the alluring tune vibrating purely within you, but you overlooked the dirty, greedily clutching hands that brought forth the melody. The highest goal and most sacred calling. That was before your eyes. You saw it bright and luminous. But in spite of all its brightness, it is merely the purest radiation of the animistic, not of the spiritual. The animal is set aglow and attains its greatest height in motherhood, becoming merged in it and yielding itself completely to it, because the animal itself originates in the animistic sphere. It attains greatness therein and becomes bright and luminous. Man, however, possesses something still stronger, which should and must stand above the animistic if he wishes to be a complete human being, the spirit. Being of the spirit, he cannot and must not remain in the animistic. He must refrain from making the highest of his goals something which belongs unconditionally to the animistic realm, and which must forever remain there in accordance with the primordial laws of creation. With exceptional cleverness, Lucifer thus laid his snare, forcing the human spirit into the animistic and holding it captive there. This was achieved all the more easily because man saw all the beauty and luminosity which emanates from everything that is pure, and which is therefore also a part of the highest animistic radiation. Yes, motherhood is certainly sacred, and its crown, mother love. But nevertheless, this is not the highest goal of human womanhood, not their mission in creation. Motherhood is rooted in the animistic and is only set aglow by a pure volition. Even if this is not always so with human beings, it is definitely always the case with animals. In spite of this, however, motherhood remains within the highest radiation of the animistic, which alone can directly coalesce with gross matter. But only he who has thoroughly studied and absorbed the Grail message will understand me fully here. What Lucifer intended with his scheming came to pass, for he knew precisely what would be the consequences of distorting the divinely instituted primordial laws, which he thereby achieved through men themselves. He only gave men a false goal, which was nicely suited to their spiritual indolence and weaknesses, and all their thinking and perceiving were adjusted accordingly, causing them inevitably to take wrong paths. Thus Lucifer only shifted the points, and the catastrophe of derailment was bound to follow. Lucifer had merely flattered the physical instinct in a deceitful manner, thereby elevating it to an immense force and power. Furthermore, he knew very well that the intellectual development of man was bound to strengthen this powerful instinct through the corresponding effect of thoughts, which may increase the pernicious desires to fever heat. Thus man finally became completely enslaved within, something which can never happen to an animal. The beautiful word motherhood remained nothing but the deceptive shield which Lucifer deceitfully conjured up in your imagination. However, the strengthening of the physical instinct, which was the inevitable consequence, was his goal. As he had plainly foreseen, it finally developed into morbidity, enslaved the minds of all people of both sexes, and turned for many into the baffling sphinx, the form in which the unhealthy instinct shows itself today, and against which man so often fights a losing battle. The root of the problem, as also its solution, lies solely in this Luciferian thought, which was thrown out to you in defiance of the laws which the will of God instituted in creation for your benefit and for the general development. And you reached out for it and were caught on it like a hungry fish on the angler's hook, just because you found pleasure in it. As for the male sex, its effect was like a serious and incurable plague. In all truth, grasp and hold within yourselves the idea of pure, sublime womanhood, and then you will be free from these heavy chains that caused you such unspeakable suffering and such anguish to your souls. Through this Luciferian thought, all earthly womanhood was robbed of what is noblest. Woman became the puppet and the prey of degraded male beings, and what is more, a lovable mother animal even to the serious-minded man. The air then became charged with this false belief, as the popular saying goes. In reality it came to life and took form in the ethereal world, hovering around you constantly and influencing you continually until you could not help but absorb it. I sever this evil connection, for it is false. Only when she has become truly conscious of her womanhood does woman stand at the highest place spiritually. And her task is not primarily dedicated to motherhood. As I have already stated, motherhood exists for your earthly body only, that is all. Yet womanhood is to be found in all spheres, even in the primordial realm, among the primordial beings, at the highest point. But it is true womanhood, in all its sublime, unapproachable dignity. It may seem as if I am taking much away from you, when I now say that motherhood belongs only to the animistic realm. It is a keen cut that I am now forced to make, if I am to help you. Motherhood remains within the realm of the animistic, and manifests on that plane. If this were her highest goal, woman would be in a very sad plight. Just observe the animal. In truth, it is very often much stronger in its instinctive mother love than a human being can ever be. For it gives itself wholly in everything it does, because it acts only on impulse and without any pondering. Thus it readily faces death for its young, and fears no enemy. The selfsame basis is also stipulated for human mother love by the laws of nature, unless it is suppressed through intellectual thinking. But it remains bound up with the body, and the body with all its radiations is animistic and not otherwise. It is true that some human beings have already felt what is right in these matters. Not without reason is it said even today that only that woman is a true mother who is also able to become a friend to her children at the proper time. What wisdom lies in this? When a mother can become a friend to her maturing daughter. This means that as soon as the girl outgrows her childhood, the mother must also change or lay aside her motherly ways altogether, if she wishes to stride onward with her child, whose spirit is breaking through in the process of maturing. As I have already...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.